Okay, let's start. So last time we studied this relation between forward interest rates and spot interest rates. Today let's see the relation between forward interest rates and forward bond prices. See, in economic theory, the following two are considered the same. One is borrowing forward, and the other is issuing a bond forward. And in theory, the following two are also the same. Lending, one is lending forward, and the other is buying a bond forward. Now to see that, let's say today is 1st of January 2016, and let's compare two similar scenarios. In one scenario, James says to the investor, can I borrow 0.9 thousand pounds, but not today, but 1 year from today, that is 1st of January 2017. I will repay 1,000 pounds on 1st of January 2019. So this is a 2 year lending and borrowing. It is a 1 year ahead, 2 year long contract, because the lending and borrowing starts 1 year from today and it will last for 2 years. We already computed the interest rate implied by this contract. So the borrowed amount is 0.9, the repaid amount is 1 after 2 years. So the implied interest rate is 5.41%. We already computed it and we introduced this notation. The first subscript is when the lending and the borrowing starts, and the second subscript is how long the lending and the borrowing will last. Now consider a slightly different situation in which James says, hi, will you buy this bond for 0.9 thousand pounds, but not today, but on 1st of January 2017. And the bond says, I, James, will pay 1,000 pounds to the owner of this paper on 1st of January 2019. If the investor agrees and signs the contract today, what happens is almost the same, actually the same as what happens in the first scenario. Basically, after 1 year, investor gives 0.9 thousand pounds to James. Then James delivers this bond to the investor. And for this bond, James has to pay 1,000 pounds in January 2019. So this is what I mean by borrowing forward, lending forward, and issuing or buying a bond forward, the same thing, at least in theory. So again, the implied interest rate is 5.41%. And this price, 0.9 thousand pounds in this example, is called forward price. Forward price of the bond. It's called the forward price because this price is not applied today, it is applied in the future. And we can denote it as the price of the bond with sub 1,2 because this price will be applied after 1 year and the bond is a 2 year contract. Okay? The bond is a 2 year bond. Is it okay? The relation between the forward bond price and this interest rate is, of course, the borrowed amount times 1 plus the annual rate squared, because in this example, the lending and the borrowing lasts for 2 years, is equal to the repaid amount, 1,000 pounds. So that's the relation between the forward bond price and the forward interest rate. So in week 3, we studied the relation between bond prices and interest rates. Those were spot bond prices and spot interest rates in the sense that the lending and the borrowing start immediately. So that's what we studied in week 3. And last time we studied the relation between the spot interest rates and forward interest rates using this no arbitrage argument. And we've just studied the relation between forward interest rates and forward bond prices. And from these three relations, you can easily derive the relation between spot bond prices and forward bond prices, which we will practice in one of the exercise questions, probably in the week 9 tutorial. Okay? Right, so those were forward contracts. Remember, we were studying derivatives, starting with derivatives with two-sided obligation, which include forward contracts, futures, and swaps. So let's do swap. And because this is the banking module, let's focus on interest rate swap contracts. Interest rate swap is an over-the-counter derivative between two banks or between a bank and some other company. As an example, let's consider two major financial institutions or banks entering into a 10-year interest rate swap contract with a notional amount of 150 million pounds. So let's call them. So there are two financial institutions, financial companies. Let's call them firm A and firm B. Let's say firm A, on the asset side, firm A had some loans with variable coupons. So someone owes to this company and they pay coupons that are linked to LIBOR. So every year, company A, firm A, has revenues in the form of LIBOR plus, 2%. Let's say on the liability side of company A, so it issued some bond in the past, and this company has to pay 10% coupon on this bond. So every year, company A pays some fixed amount of money to some creditors. Now for company B, let's say company B provides some mortgages and they have fixed rate revenues every year. And they fund these mortgages by issuing some short-term certificates of deposits or some money products whose interest rates are linked to LIBOR. And LIBOR changes all the time. So let's say they have to pay, every year they have to pay LIBOR plus something, 1%. Now both, in this example, both companies face interest rate risk. LIBOR changes all the time. If LIBOR goes up, that's good for company A because they are receiving LIBOR. It's bad for company B because they are paying LIBOR. If LIBOR goes down, that's good for company B, but that's bad for company A. So both companies are subject to risk from changing interest rate. Now what they can do is to swap their interest revenue. So company A agrees to pay LIBOR to company B every year. And in return for that, company B pays some fixed amount, let's say X percent, to company A. And they do that for the next 10 years, every year. And after this agreement, company A receives LIBOR, but they also pay LIBOR. Company B has to pay LIBOR, but they also receive LIBOR. So after making such an agreement, arrangement, both companies have less risk of changing interest rate. Does that make sense? Now, like forward contract, swap contract is also a fair deal at the point of contracting. So at the point of signing the contract should specify this X percent. And this X percent should be such that at the point of signing the contract, both companies think that this is a fair deal, so that neither makes cash payment to the other at the point of signing the contract. But of course, as time passes, the LIBOR changes, and one side becomes the winner of the contract, and the other side becomes the loser of the contract. This X percent is specified in the contract, and this X percent is called swap rate. And because this is a 10-year contract, it is called 10-year swap rate. Okay, that's the fixed rate in return for LIBOR. If the contract has different length, if it's 3-year contract, then the swap rate, this X is called 3-year swap rate. If it is 20-year contract, then it's 20-year swap rate. And if you plot all these swap rates for various maturities, it is called swap curve. So in October 2015 in the United States, this was the swap curve. The swap rate for one-year contract was 0.55%. The swap rate that X in the previous slide, the X was 2.08% for the 10-year contracts. Those are fixed rates in return for receiving 3-month LIBOR for the next several years. The 30-year swap rate was 2.56%, which means that if, let's say, imagine that two US banks, Bank of America and JP Morgan Chase, entered into a 30-year contract with $1 billion notional amount in October 2015. This is what happens for 30 years, every 3 months, for the next 30 years. Let's say Bank of America is the variable rate receiver and the fixed rate payer, and JP Morgan is the variable rate payer and the fixed rate receiver. So every 3 months, JP Morgan Chase pays the notional amount £1 billion times 3 months LIBOR divided by 4. Okay, all the rate is annual rate, and they do this every 3 months. So they divide by 4. And that's what JP Morgan Chase pays to Bank of America every 3 months for 30 years. And in return for that, Bank of America pays the notional amount £1 billion times, well, when they signed the contract, the swap rate for 30-year contract was 2.56%. So 2.56% divided by 4, and that's £6.4 million. Okay, that's what Bank of America pays to JP Morgan every 3 months. So there's nothing uncertain about what Bank of America owes to JP Morgan. It's specified in the contract. What is uncertain is what JP Morgan Chase owes to Bank of America every 3 months, because LIBOR changes every 3 months. Okay? Now, this is the simplest type of interest rate swap. It's called plain vanilla swap. No additional flavors or toppings. It's just plain interest rate swap. Okay, it's just about exchanging variable rate and fixed rate. Another important interest rate swap is overnight indexed swap, OIS. So plain vanilla swap can be a very long-term contract, sometimes 10 years, 20 years, 30 years. In contrast, OIS is typically much shorter, like 3 months or 6 months. As an example, let's think of a 3 month overnight indexed swap contract on the notional amount £100 million with swap rate X percent. Again, X is determined and specified in the contract. This is what happens 3 months later. So let's say Bank A is the fixed rate payer and Bank B is the floating rate, variable rate payer. So they agreed upon X, and 3 months later, this is what happens. Bank A pays the notional amount £100 million times 1 plus X over 300X percent divided by 360 days to the power 90 days, because there are 90 days in 3 months, and this is a 3 month contract, minus the notional amount £100 million. So the interest rate swap is always about exchanging the interest. Okay, they exchange only interest part, they never exchange the principal or face value. So we don't call it face value or principal, it's just notional amount to compute the amount of interest. So we subtract the notional amount, and in return for that, so there's nothing uncertain about what Bank A owes to Bank B. Now, in return for that, what Bank B pays to Bank A is the interest that would have been accrued if the bank had kept lending the £100 million at a sequence of overnight interest rates for the 90 days. So the overnight LIBOR is called SONIA. And imagine SONIA After they signed the contract, imagine that the SONIA evolved in this way. So the SONIA on the first day was 0.43%, SONIA on the second day was 0.435%, and so on. And let's say the SONIA on the last day, the SONIA on the 90th day was 0.427%. Then, after 3 months, after they sign the contract, what Bank B pays to Bank A is the notional amount £100 million times 1 plus the SONIA on the first day divided by 360 days times 1 plus the SONIA on the second day divided by 360 days and so on times 1 plus the SONIA on the 90th day divided by 360 days minus the notional amount. Again, they don't exchange the principal, they exchange only interest part. Okay? So there's nothing uncertain about what Bank A pays to Bank B, but what Bank B pays to Bank A is uncertain because when they sign the contract, they don't know how SONIA will evolve for the next 90 days. And this is overnight index swap. This plays an important role when we study financial crisis and those things in an interbank market in week 10 or week 9. So yeah, we'll come back to this topic later. But is OIS okay? Right. Okay, so derivatives with two-sided obligation include forward contracts, swaps, and futures. Most forward contracts and swaps are, we studied interest rate, forward lending and borrowing, and interest rate swaps, but these things are not necessarily for future lending and borrowing. There are forward contracts for like buying and selling stocks or stock index in the future. There are swaps such as currency swaps or credit default swaps. Many forward contracts and swaps are over-the-counter contracts. So two parties sit together over-the-counter contracts. So two parties sit together over-the-counter and then agree upon a contract, they sign a contract. There's no centralized market. Over-the-counter contracts are good, they are tailored, they are customized. So over-the-counter contracts can meet a variety of demand. But there are also bad side. Over-the-counter contracts, there's no centralized market. So if your company or if your bank wants to sign some forward contract, you have to find a counterparty. Okay, you have to find someone who wants to sign the contract with you. Even if you can find someone and agree upon a contract and sign the contract, counterparty risk arises. So as time passes, when signing the contract, it's a fair bet, fair deal. But as time passes, one side, makes a loss, becomes the loser of the contract, and that party may default. Okay, someone might fail to honor the contract. That's counterparty risk. And also, another bad thing about over-the-counter contract is that once you sign the contract, it's hard to close the position before the contract ends. So let's say your company signs some contract, forward contract, 10-year contract, but 3 years later, the situation has changed, the environment has changed, so your company no longer wants this contract. They want to quit the contract, but you cannot because the other side, the counterparty, needs this contract. Does that make sense? Yes, even if you change your mind, you cannot easily stop the contract. It was my first year in Exeter. It was around this time of the year. I had my hair cut near the clock tower, and I was walking home, right? It was the evening, and it was raining, and I was
walking along the Richmond Road, checking emails with my iPhone. And there was, you know, on the sidewalk, there was a pole, the road sign. And I bumped into it, and I hit my head, and I dropped my iPhone. And on the, you know, beside the sidewalk, there was a sewage, drainage hole, and the phone disappeared into it. And I heard the phone drop into water in the distance, and I was like, oh, I've just lost my phone. So I immediately ran to Vodafone's office. They were close to closing, but yeah, I made it. So I talked to a lady in the Vodafone about my situation, and she said, well, I'm very sorry, but your phone wasn't insured. So I said, that's fine, but I don't think, I mean, can I stop my contract? I don't think I will get another brand new iPhone anytime soon, and I don't think I need this much data, so can I stop my contract? And the contract didn't include the phone itself. The monthly payment just included the calls and texts and data. It didn't include the price for my phone itself. So I thought it was possible, but the lady said, I'm afraid you cannot. It's a 2-year contract, and you still have 8 months to go. So I said, OK, then can I resell my contract? The lady frowned. So I said, I mean, if I bring anyone, my family, a friend, can that person take over my contract? The lady said, oh yes, you can. The contract is transferable. So if you bring anyone, we'll check the credit history of that person. If the credit is fine, then that person can take over your contract. So that was the good news. But the problem was that I couldn't find such a person. I was sure that in this wide country, there must have been at least one person who would have been happy to have this exactly 8-month-long contract. But there wasn't any, you know, the phone contract was the over-the-counter contract between me and Vodafone. And there wasn't any centralized market like Uber or Airbnb, so I couldn't find anyone to whom I can sell this contract. Okay? So that's the problem of over-the-counter contracts. Now, futures solve that problem. Futures are exchange-traded forward contracts. Futures are not available for all kinds of forward contracts and swaps. But for some very common forward contracts, futures are available. They are exchange-traded forward contracts. There isn't much variety. There are only like several contracts. So they are standardized, and everyone has to buy these contracts. But if you want one, if you want to sign one contract, then you don't have to find the counterparty yourself. I mean, the exchange will find your contracting party for you. You don't even have to know who is your counterparty, because even if the counterparty defaults, the exchange, the stock exchange, ensures that you will get what you should get from the contract. Okay? The exchange will provide guarantees. And so there's no counterparty risk. And if you want to close your position, okay, you sign some long-term contract, but now situation has changed, so you want to quit, then you can easily close the position. If you want to close the position, the stock exchange will find someone else to replace you. If you are winning on the bet, then when you close the position, you will get paid some money. If you are rather losing on the bet, then you have to pay something when you close the position. But either way, you can quit. Okay? Again, for the over-the-counter contracts, you cannot easily do that. You cannot tell the other counterparty saying, you know, you cannot say, okay, I want to seize this contract. You cannot say that.
I mean, you can say that, but it's hard. So most of the time, you have to sign another bet, another contract with someone else that effectively cancels out the former contract, the former bet. That's for over-the-counter contract. Any question? Right, so let's move on to derivatives with one-sided obligations, that is put options and call options. Call options are an option. Call options are a right to buy something, and put options are a right to sell something, for both for a predetermined price. And the option contract should specify strike price, that is the price at which the trade should take place in the future, and the maturity date or expiration date of the contract, and whether the option is a European type or American type. European type option can be exercised only at the last date, okay, only at the maturity date, while the American option can be exercised any time between today and the expiration date. So in that sense, American option gives more option to the option holder. Let's go back to our previous examples from last time to see whether those examples were, if anything, a call option or a put option. In one example, so the story was that the University K gives you admission, so you get an offer. You are not sure yet if you want to go to the university. So you pay £1,000 to University K, and the university reserves a place for you for the next 1.5 months. Now this £1,000 is the price of the option for you to come back and pay the full tuition and get the studentship. So I would say it's a call option, if anything. It's an option for you to buy the studentship from the university. And the strike price is the tuition, full tuition. And the maturity date, expiration date is, I mean, maturity is 1.5 months. Okay? What about this, that Swedish krona and currency company example? So you pay extra £4 to TravelX or American Express, so that when you come back from your trip to Sweden, you can resell your unspent Swedish krona back to the currency company to get British pounds back. I would call it put option because it is the right for you to sell unspent Swedish krona. But of course, if you're a Swedish person, you might think, okay, I'm buying British pounds, so it is a call option. What about flight cancellation? So the plane ticket is £100, but you pay extra £20 so that you can cancel your trip, flight before departure, and £100 will be refunded. I would say it's a put option, because by canceling your flight, you are reselling your plane ticket back to the airline company, okay? So that's the right for you to resell the plane ticket back to the company. So it's put option. How about flight change? So you pay extra money, and before departure, you can change your flight. I would say it's both, because by changing a flight, you are both selling the old ticket and buying a new ticket at the same time. The letting example was that, okay, so then you pay half the monthly rent to the landlord, the owner of the property, and the landlord will reserve this property for you for the next 2 weeks, so that within 2 weeks you can come back and sign the tenancy contract. I would say it's neither, because lease contract, it is itself a two-sided obligation. So once you sign the contract, you are obliged to pay monthly rent for the next 1 year, for the next 12 months. So it's not simply buying tenancy, but you can also say that if anything, that example was a call option, that is the option for you to buy the lease. Now, in finance, call and put options are the right to buy or sell some other financial assets, some other securities. Now, our next topic is, so the next thing we want to learn is the theory to evaluate put options and call options and other derivatives, okay? The theory to price options. Now, the theory that allows you to price options and other derivatives is the no-arbitrage pricing theory. And for this module, we learn the fundamental, the very basic part of the no-arbitrage pricing theory so that you can understand what banks are actually, so that you can get some vague idea of what banks are actually doing when they trade derivatives. A core assumption for this theory, no-arbitrage pricing theory for options and other derivatives, is that anyone can freely buy and sell products or assets without any transaction fees, which is a very strong assumption. I mean, obviously, you know that to buy or sell things, you need a lot of time or efforts. Sometimes you have to pay some money. But for this theory, we assume that transaction is free, which is not necessarily a terrible assumption for financial assets, because for some financial assets and contracts, you can buy or sell them with your computer by a couple of clicks. Now, the following is the simplest example of the no-arbitrage pricing theory. Suppose one apple is priced 50 pence. Suppose one apple is 50 pence. Then what would be the price of a bundle of three apples? It should be £1 and 50 pence. If one apple is 50 pence, then the price of three apples should be £1 and 50 pence. What happens if it is not £1 and 50 pence? Well, suppose the price of the bundle of three apples is £1 and 51 pence. If that is the case, you can buy three apples, each for 50 pence, put them together, make a bundle, and the bundle can be sold for £1 and 51 pence in the market. So you can do that, and after doing that, you have 1 pence left in your hand, and that's free money, that's arbitrage. 1 pence sounds like a very small amount, but if you do that by a large quantity, let's say you buy 3 billion apples each for 50 pence, and you make 1 billion bundles, and you sell all these bundles, each for £1 and 51 pence, then after doing that, you have 1 billion pence in your hand, and that's arbitrage opportunity. Similarly, if one apple is 50 pence, but the bundle of three apples is £1 and 49 pence in the market, then you can buy a bundle for £1 and 49 pence, break the bundle, and sell each apple for 50 pence, and after doing that, you have 1 pence left in your hand, and that's free money, that's arbitrage opportunity. If there was any such arbitrage opportunity, then everyone would want to do that forever to get free money. So that's very unlikely in the real market. So if one apple is 50 pence, then the price of three apples should be £1 and 50 pence. Okay, this is the no-arbitraging pricing. The price of one apple implies the theoretical price of a bundle of three apples. Does that make sense? So far, so good? even the more advanced non-arbitraging pricing formulas, theories like Black-Scholes formula, shares this, you know, very basic idea. Have you ever heard of Black-Scholes formula? Who has heard of the Black-Scholes formula? 1, 2, 3, maybe 10 people? Okay. So these people like Fisher Black and Myron Scholes and Robert Martin invented this formula for pricing options, European call option, and they got awarded, well, Myron Scholes and Robert Martin got a Nobel Memorial Prize in economics in 1990s. Fisher Black was already deceased, so he didn't get the prize. But anyway, even their pioneering work is very mathematically advanced using stochastic calculus, but even their idea is based on this very simple idea of non-arbitrage pricing. So we want to study non-arbitrage pricing theory for options and other derivatives. But before doing that, let us see one more example, one more fruits example, okay? And I think that will help you to understand the non-arbitrage pricing for options and derivatives. Think about three, let's say in the market, there are three bundles of apples. And these three bundles are the only bundles that are available in the market. Bundle A contains two apples and one banana. The current market price is £1.30. Bundle B contains five apples and two bananas. The current market price is £3. And bundle C contains three apples and three bananas and one pineapple. The current market price is £4.70. And those are the only things that are currently traded in the market. Question one, what are the implied prices of an apple and of a banana? Let's denote the price of one apple P by PA, and let's denote the price of one banana by PB. Then these bundle prices imply that two times the price of one apple plus one times the price of one banana should be equal to the price of bundle A, £1.30, and similarly, five times the price of one apple plus two times the price of one banana should be equal to the price of bundle B, £3. So we have these two equations. If you solve it, it's PA is 40 pence and PB is 50 pence. It's a very simple high school math, and you might be wondering what it has to do with non-arbitrage pricing of options and derivatives. You'll see that. But is it okay? If you have computer, you can use inverse matrix function. If you are working on pen and paper, with a pen and paper, then you can solve it in a normal way. So far, so good? The price of apple and price of banana implied by these bundle prices is 40 pence and 50 pence, respectively. Is it okay so far? Question two. If you want to buy just one apple, okay, the assumption is that these three bundles are the only things that are currently traded in the market, but suppose you just want one apple, you don't want any banana. What can you do? And how much would it cost to do so? No one sells just one apple for you. But there is a way for you to get just one apple and no banana. By combining these bundles, suppose you buy YA units of bundle A and YB units of bundle B. Then, the total amount of apples you have, you get, is 2 times YA plus 5 times YB. The total number of bananas you have is 1 times YA plus 2 times YB. If you get this YA units of bundle A and YB units of bundle B. And you want the number of apples to be equal to 1, and you want the number of bananas to be equal to 0. And if you solve it, YA is minus 2 and YB is 1. So if you buy 1 unit of bundle B, and at the same time sell 2 units of bundle A, well, you're buying 5 apples, but selling 2 times doing good 4 apples, so you end up with 1 apple, and you end up with no banana. So you can have only 1 apple in your hand. Now the cost of doing that is, you're buying 1 unit of bundle B, so that costs £3, but at the same time you're selling 2 units of bundle A, so you get cash of 2 times £1.30, so the total cost of doing that is 40 pence, which coincides with the theoretical upper price we derived in question 1, and that's not just coincidence. So far so good? Yeah? What if you want just 1 banana and you don't want any apple? The story is the same. Imagine you buy YA units of bundle A and YB units of bundle B. This is the total number of apples you get, 2 times YA plus 5 times YB. The total number of bananas you get is 1 times YA plus 2 times YB. You want the number of apples to be 0, and you want the number of bananas to be exactly 1. And if you solve it, YA is 5, YB is minus 2. So if you buy 5 units of bundle A, and at the same time sell 2 units of bundle B, after doing that, you have no apples in your hand, but you have 1 banana left in your hand. The cost of doing that is 5 times the price of bundle A, because you are buying 5 units of bundle A, minus 2 times of £3, because you are selling 2 units of bundle B, equal 50 pence. Again, it coincides with the theoretical banana price we derived in question 1. Next question. What is the price of bundle D? Here we introduce a new bundle, bundle D, which has 2 apples and 2 bananas. So it's different from the other 3 bundles. What should be the theoretical price of this new bundle? There are two ways to compute it. One is to use our result from question 1. In question 1, we derived the theoretical price of 1 apple, that was 40 pence. The theoretical price of 1 banana was 50 pence. This bundle contains 2 apples and 2 bananas, so the theoretical price should be 2 times 40 pence plus 2 times 50 pence equal £1.80. That's one way. Another way to derive the theoretical price of bundle D is to replicate this bundle D by other bundles. So imagine you buy YA units and YB units of bundle A and bundle B. Again, the total number of apples you get is 2 times YA plus 5 times YB. The total number of bananas you have is 1 times YA plus 2 times YB. And to replicate bundle D, the number of apples should be 2, the number of bananas should be 2. If you solve it, YA is 6 and YB is minus 2. So if you buy 6 units of bundle A and sell 2 units of bundle B, you have the same result as buying bundle D. Now, the cost of doing that is 6 times £1.30 minus 2 times £3 equal £1.80, and that should be the theoretical price of bundle D. The idea is that if there are 2 things, so this is the replica, by buying 6 units of bundle A and selling 2 units of bundle B, you can make a replica of bundle D, something that is exactly identical to bundle D, and the law of one price, you know, in economics, if there are 2 exactly identical things, they should have the same price. If the market price of bundle D, which contains 2 apples and 2 bananas, in the market is different from the price we found in question 4, £1.18, what would happen? So in question 4, we derived that the theoretical price of this bundle should be £1.80. If the market price is different from that theoretical price, let's say it's £1.81, then you can take arbitrage. to make a replica of bundle D, the cost is £1.80. If you have £1.80 by buying and selling bundles A and B, you can make a replica of bundle D. But the market price of bundle D is £1.81, so you can make a lot of replicas and you can sell them as bundle D and you get free money. That's arbitrage opportunity. Similarly, if the market price of bundle D is £1.79, while the cost of replica is £1.80, then you can buy a lot of bundle D's. You can buy a lot of bundle. You can buy a lot of bundle D and sell them as sell a lot of replicas. And by doing that, you have free money in your hand. And that's arbitrage opportunity. And there shouldn't be any arbitrage opportunity in the market, so the price of bundle D should be equal to £1.80. And last question, what is the theoretical price of bundle C? What should be the price of one pineapple implied by the price of bundle C? This is the equation. PA is the price of one apple, PB is the price of one banana, PP is the price of one pineapple, and the price of bundle C should imply this last equation, 3 times the price of apple plus 3 times the price of one banana plus the price of one pineapple should be equal to £4.70. We already got the price of apple and price of banana in question 1. So if we substitute those prices, PP, the price of one pineapple, is equal to £2. Let me talk about the first question of the assignment. The price you should use is adjusted price, okay? So if you go to Yahoo Finance and go to historical prices of the 5 companies you chose, they show like open price, close price, high price, low price. But forget about these other prices. What you should use is the adjusted close price, okay? And from this series, you should compute the series of returns. Adjusted price takes 2 things into account, dividends and stock split. The dividend definition we studied in week 1, that was the very first thing we learned in this module, includes dividends. I mean, the return formula we studied includes dividends, yeah? So you should include dividends when you compute stock return. It makes sense. If you are a shareholder, you own the company, right? So everything the company has belongs to you, the buildings, machines, even cash. So if the company has a safe and a lot of cash in the safe, that cash belongs to you if you are a shareholder. So if the company takes some cash out of the safe and pays those cash as dividends to shareholders, basically you're receiving your own money. And after that, it's very likely, it's not very surprising, that the price of the company's share drops because now the company has less cash. It doesn't make much sense if you don't include dividends when you compute return, especially if the company pays a lot of dividends. Now, if you use adjusted price, then the dividends are already somehow taken into account. So you don't have to worry about dividends. Okay? Secondly, adjusted price also takes stock split into account. Sometimes companies split their shares, stocks. They say, okay, from today on, each share counts as 2. Okay? We are going to split one share into 2. Let's say you have 100 shares, each share is £100. Okay? Suppose you have 100 shares and each share is worth £100. So the total value is £10,000, right? And the company says, okay, from today on, each share counts as 2. You had 100 shares, each share was worth £100. Now you have 200 shares, each share is worth £50. The total value is still £10,000, but if you see the crude price series, it says yesterday £100, today's price £50. It doesn't mean that the company's value plunged. They just split the shares, okay? Now, if you look at the adjusted price series, it also takes the stock split into account. So that today's price is 50, yesterday's price is also recorded as 50. Okay, so as long as you adjust the price, you don't have to worry about stock split. Anyway, thank you for coming, and I'll see you next week.